You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome to the third story for the month of November 2023, issue 206. I hope that the stories thus far have been treating me very well. You can always send us a note over at kate@clarksworldmagazine.com, and that's Clark with an E. As per the usual, I want to thank you for your ongoing support of the magazine, whether that is a monthly donation at patreon.com/clarksworld, a subscription to the magazine. We're building those numbers back up after Amazon completely decimated that. So thank you if you have been supporting the magazine, whether this is your first podcast or somewhere near 1,000. And if you haven't yet, please consider doing so. Our story is titled The Long Mural and is by James Van Pelt. James Van Pelt has been selling short fiction to many of the major venues since 1989. Recently, he retired from teaching high school English after 37 years in the classroom. He has been a finalist for the Nebula, the Theodore Sturgeon Memorial Award, Locus Awards, and Analog and Asimov's Reader's Choice Awards. Years and years ago, he was a finalist for the John W. Campbell Award for Best New Writer. He still feels new. Fairwood Press recently released a huge limited edition signed and numbered collection of his work, The Best of James Van Pelt. And if you like what you hear, go back to Solace. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax. Let me tell you a story. You do a really nice bird, said Hua from her step stool above, shimmeless. He noticed a strand of black hair sticking to her cheek. She brushed it with the back of her hand, which left a brown streak matching the branch she worked on. It's tough to get the tail feathers right, Shimmeless said. My name means bluebird. Did you know that? How appropriate. Hua leaned back and studied his work. It's American Indian, right? Do you know what tribe? She braced her elbow against the unpainted wall below her tree and then added a detail. The mural so far stretched along the hallway to their right until it curved up out of sight. To their left, unpainted metal, punctuated by doors and a corridor, curved up too. Shimmeless never shook the feeling he rested at a wheel's bottom, like the bottom of a hamster wheel. A chatting couple strolled toward them, but neither glanced at the painting as they passed. Shimmeless shrugged. The Lenape in Delaware. I'm led to understand something Algonquian, anyway. It's a homage to a great-great-grandparent. The rest of the lineage isn't nearly as interesting. How about you? Hua is pretty. She grunted. I think three other girls were named Hua in my first year of primary school. It means flower, but common as a daisy. I've never met another Shimmeless. He picked a fine-tipped brush from a tray, dipped it into the chestnut brown, then mixed it into the onyx black. Hopefully just the right shade to etch the wing feathers and highlight the blue. The mural committee designated a 6 a.m. sun position for this section, with the point of view looking west. A mellower light than full noon, and he could add shadows falling behind the subject. It's a scrub jay, he said, not a bluebird. I miss birds, Hua said. Videos fall short. I grew up in Beijing. Sparrows flocked in the tree by our apartment, noisy little things. What I liked most were the hoopoes in the park. They called their name, hoopo, hoopo, hoopo. Made my sisters laugh. Shimmeless tucked the name away in memory. He'd look it up later. The line under the feather completed the look well. He added more, darkening the color as he moved down the wing. Does it bother you we'll never finish the project? Painters who aren't born yet will continue when we're gone. At least we have actually seen our subjects. Hua shrugged. Does anyone reach the end of anything? Do you think there will be birds on Zeta Reticuli? Shimmeless smiled. Parallel evolution says it's possible, if there's life at all. He'd worked near her several times in the last month. She was the closest thing to a friend on board. I'm getting hungry, she said. Do you want to go to the cafeteria with me? His hand shook, messing the last stroke. He dabbed at it with a cloth. No thanks, he said, calming his breath. I'm on a roll, maybe some other time. She shrugged. Menu modifications today, different choices in the buffet. I like when we get something new. Well, hopefully a tasty change. Hua wiped her brush, put it in her art kit, then folded the step stool. See you next time. She stepped back to survey the mural. He thought she had a jaunty look, fists on her hips, chin up. paint on her cheek. There's always more trees, but only so many hours to spend. You can vox me if you change your mind. She touched the pants pocket where Shimalis assumed she kept her communicator. When she left, Shimalis sat on the floor, resting his forearms on his knees. He liked painting the birds, the decisions about their posture, their gesture. This scrub jay's head tilted to the side as if listening for other birds. He remembered walking along the line of mesquite beside a trail a lifetime ago, startling a family of scrub jay. They exploded from the bush in front of him, flew 30 feet, and vanished into another mesquite. When he approached, they did it again, half a dozen more times before they decided he wasn't stopping, so they flew into the sky, screeching disapproval. He really was hungry, so he repainted the ruined line, cleaned his brush and palette, and packed them away, returning the paint kit to the table with Hua's box and the others. Hua had left to the north and the unpainted hall. Shimalis walked south, admiring the forest, a flowered meadow, and a long canyoned landscape where the shadows grew shorter and shorter, and he was at noon in the mural, until he passed two cafeterias in case Hua had gone to her room first, and then came back to eat. At the door, nutritionist Jerome, a slight figure with nervous eyes and unruly hair, nodded his way. If asked, he would suggest meals. The cafeteria was a third full with 20 or so diners. It smelled of coffee and garlic. He liked this, the get-me-there eatery. Each cafeteria was whimsically named. The two he'd skipped were Chef Charisse's Cafe and the Grand Grill. The staff came up with the specialties only available in their space, but despite best efforts, they were more similar than unique. The get-me-there added cornbread in the carbohydrate section, a squash and zucchini medley in vegetables, and a lemon pudding in desserts, which he was sorry to see because he liked the brownies they replaced. He positioned himself away from groups at other tables, finished his meal with his head down, moved to the back and scanned the crowd. A woman wearing a white smock looked at him several tables away, turned her attention to her food. Shimalis' skin chilled. She seemed familiar. Had he seen her before? Watching him. He stood with his hand on a maintenance hatch handle for several seconds, waiting to see if she looked up again. But she continued with her meal. He opened the hatch, put on a biofilter mask, and sighed in relief when he closed himself in. Stupid, he said to himself as he made his way down the tight corridor, careful not to brush against the numerous pipes and conduits. He told Hua too much. At a junction, he stepped around the corner, then stopped, his back to the wall. Had anyone followed him? He waited a minute, then peeked back the way he'd come. Nothing behind him. A woman wearing a maintenance crew jumper, like Shimalis's, came around the corner. How's it going? She said as she squeezed past him. Her name tag said Linda, but Shimalis thought of her as Fungus Girl because she customized the back of her work shirt with the slogan, Beating the Fungus Among Us. Overhead, a thin line of LEDs provided meager illumination. Shadows were deep. His footsteps hardly made a sound that the low, murmuring gurgle from a water duct didn't cover. Here, the air was cooler than the main habitat, and it smelled faintly of cleaners and lubricants. He took several turns, climbed two ladders, passed through more doors until he reached a hatch like hundreds of others marked LN-47. A hair he'd placed at the top was undisturbed. He listened, nothing unexpected. No conversation or clink of tools, just ship noises, whispery and easy to ignore, like dry leaves rubbing together, and the slightest hum, the vibration that told him all was peaceful. He navigated the dark room beyond by penlight. Tall containers coated with their contents reached to a high ceiling on either side. Heavy equipment tightly wrapped stood like brooding giants, almost no reason for anyone to come here except for maintenance inspections, which were scheduled and easy for him to avoid. Almost at the back of the cavernous room, he turned into a gap between containers too narrow to walk freely. He shuffled to the end. Finally, he emerged into a space 10 feet long and 4 feet wide. Someone who knew the storage area would recognize his folded mattress, blanket, and change of work clothes didn't belong. He pulled out the mattress and spread it. Something tiny jumped away. Shimalis trained his light on it just before it disappeared in the half-inch space between the huge container and the wall. It was a cricket. He liked crickets. Sometime early in the voyage, a few had escaped the entomophagy kitchen. Run, little cricket, he thought. Before he clicked off his light, he considered if he should stop working on the mural. What if Hua grew interested enough in him to look him up? How could he answer her questions? What if she wanted to grow close? Shimalus shivered at the thoughts. He should have never have talked to her, not over the course of many days. 16,000 traveled with him, almost 40 million square feet of space on the outer rim alone, and the hula hoop was multiple levels deep. People live their entire lives without seeing all of it. He could remain undiscovered if he avoided attention. When he stood among them, not much marked him as different. Looking at him wouldn't reveal that he didn't have a cabin, or an assigned duty, or a name on the roster. A search of his pockets would show he didn't have a vox, but he could claim that he'd left it somewhere. You didn't need to talk to everyone all the time, after all. Little would distinguish him from the others. On a generation ship to Zeta Reticuli, 39 light years distant, a trip that would take 1,000 years, everyone on board had a place. They'd been picked for health and genetic diversity, screened for psychological stability, chosen among the billions who'd been left behind. Everyone selected and invited except Shimalus, the stowaway. The Long Mural project began 10 months into the journey. Shimalus knew nothing about it then. He spent most of his time in the tiny area where he'd settled behind boxcar-sized inventory cases in one of the numerous storage rooms, flinching at every unexpected sound in the dark. What was that? Have they discovered me? Is this the end? Rough hands and angry faces filled his visions. You don't belong, they'd shout, and then he would be thrust into an airlock. He imagined the door wheezing shut behind him, metal bolts locking into place. Would his last look be at his executioners peering at him with hate through the porthole windows? Or would he face the door to vacuum before the servo mechanism's groan pulled the heavy barrier aside? Would he cling to the ship or ride the airy gust into the void? Could happen to the unwanted, he learned. It already had. His first few weeks aboard frightened him the most. He'd hidden on a supply ship to the Ark. There were so many, and they'd been shuttling back and forth for years. Security wasn't tight in orbit, and urgency made it worse. So when he slipped into the Ark, no one asked him who he was or told him what to do. He wandered through the halls and then into the maintenance shafts, looking for a place to remain undiscovered. While those who belonged, the chosen travelers, to Zeta Reticuli, went to their rooms they would occupy for the rest of their lives, he worked the service corridors, emerging only for food. No ID checks in the cafeteria or anywhere else. He showered in the maintenance locker room. No one questioned him while he worked. The danger was someone discovering his mattress and clothes. It wouldn't take much to raise suspicion. But weeks rolled by without discovery. He became bolder, walked through cafeterias like a colonist, being careful to visit different ones each time. Attended concerts, strolled the halls, responded to greetings, listened to the ship gossip, never joining in. But mostly he stayed in the service corridors, avoiding maintenance workers, solitary figures like himself. Although they were part of the known, the counted, genuine, the recruited. After his third year aboard, he overheard a story in passing, a whispered tale that he didn't dare ask about. Everyone on board knew it, evidently. Asking would reveal an inexplicable ignorance. Once in the cafeteria, someone said, as bad as the secessionists. A few days later, a longer phrase caught his attention. The boogeyman can be real, like those Latimer secessionist nut jobs. But shipboard conversation often contained comments he knew nothing about. Also, most got news from their vox. He didn't have a vox. Who were the Latimer secessionists? Why do they matter? 10 months into the journey, while the sun was still recognizably the sun behind them, and not an inconsequential star among stars, by then appreciably smaller, someone started the mural with a beach. The sun, the remembered sun, the beating, pounding, pouring heat source they all recalled setting into the ocean, a single palm tree in a sawgrass foreground. No one saw the painter, no one took credit, but weeks later the sawgrass crawled a few feet south. Clearly the work of a different artist. Spontaneous art, guerrilla art, art without expectation, graffiti at worst, vandalism even. But some pause as they passed, their errands interrupted for an instant to smile. Even 10 months into a journey that would last beyond their lifetimes, the lone palm tree mostly a silhouette against the dying light, reminded them of sacrifice, of loss. A committee formed that proposed an ambitious plan, a patient one, and the Long Mural project took form, a painting that would stretch for 3 miles, the length of the entire 10-feet-high main hall that completed the ship's circumference. The shadows would change with the sun's progress, an entire day from dawn to dusk covering 200 yards, before darkness fell in moonlight or starlight or a lamp burning in a rough log cabin provided illumination for the night shapes. A home for owls and possums and fearful mice before the sun lightened the scene again, and the next day began hundreds of yards farther down, painted by whoever wanted to join. No schedule, on a largely automated ship that operated with little care. The thousands on board needed activities to fill their minds, to occupy their hands. So an orchestra formed, and book clubs and poetry readings, and poetry contests, quite cutthroat already, and dance troupes and sculpture clubs. Movies were written and filmed and screened, an outpouring of focused creative endeavor. Everybody had a hobby. And there was the painting, going every day except when no one came. For weeks, sometimes, the project stalled until an artist took up the brush again. Not all the painters knew each other. Some tried their hand only once. Others were regulars. Learning about the Long Mural came easily. Artists chatted while they painted. Shimalus's curiosity was unremarked. The secessionist story came harder, much later, after some research on an unattended computer. He learned that, at about the same time the mural began, Latimer was already holding meetings with a group who would become his following. Most of the article discussed the shortcomings of psychological profiling, and how Latimer should have never been chosen to go to Zeta Reticuli. Shimalus walked by the painting 4 months ago, 12 years after it started. He'd watched it grow from the beginning. At the end, he saw a spot, a perfect perch on a bare branch that begged for a starling. So he stopped, opened a paint kit on a table left for the next artist, and sketched in an outline, glancing around, convinced a hand would fall on his shoulder. "You don't belong," the voice would say. Still, he painted. He'd taken a drawing class 15 years past. It filled an empty spot in his schedule. Basics in shape and shading, perspective. He doodled ever since when he grew restless in other classes, in the evening when he was alone, even when he took his first job on Marriott's orbiting resort. They said, "See the world from our 5-star restaurant. Relax at our interstellar spa." Shimalus sketched portraits in a notebook, drew tiny landscapes. When Shimalus finished the starling, his first contribution, he quivered with joy. Now something of him existed on the ship. He'd been thinking lately of how his life could go. He'd stowed away to escape, but he was younger then and hadn't thought it through. If he hid forever, never reaching Zeta Reticuli, just as everyone in the first generation would not, he would eventually die, probably on his thin mattress, hidden in a storage area. Perhaps he'd remained there for years before his body was found, maybe even 1,000 years. A colonizer, 40 generations removed, might come upon his skeleton and be horrified. Of course, but he would be a mystery, the uninvited passenger. Or maybe they wouldn't even consider the possibility that he was a founding traveler. In that much time, he might have been from much later in Ark history. Surely in 1,000 years, someone might be eccentric enough to hide in a storage room. Maybe they might wonder if he was a victim, a murdered soul, what a cold case he would become. But they would never know for sure. The starling was his, a public mark he'd left. It might not last 1,000 years. Surely in that time, the original mural could vanish. The painters years from now, who completed the hallway adding their last stroke that finished the circle, might go on, covering the first painting with a new one. How many times might the hall be artistically repurposed? But these weren't his thoughts so long ago, it seemed, before he stowed away. He cleaned at the Marriott. His title was Microbiome Abatement Specialist. He sought mold and bacteria infestations, classified them, destroyed them. And when he didn't do that, he swept and polished and took trash to the recycler. The same needs existed on the Ark. No one noticed the janitors. When construction ship after cargo ship and finally cruise ships paused at the Marriott, bound for the generation ships being built farther out, when he watched the news on Earth how mutagens were reshaping life, changing everything, and how the starbound vessels were last chance, Shimalus planned. Hua knelt on the floor at the mural. Shimalus stopped, almost turned around before she looked up, but he had an idea about a cloud behind his bluebird. He dreamed, and as he woke, a broad billowing pillow catching the rising sun, orange on the bottom below the gray and blue bulk, like smoke above coals. He remembered clouds when so much had already slipped away. He told himself he had been in cities, but he couldn't recall their smell, how a sidewalk felt in the winter after a sprinkling of snow left tiny crystals that crunched, how a car horn squawked, an angry mechanical goose. Did people talk loud enough for him to hear their conversation? Did he really recall a single encounter with a stranger? One of a city's greatest joys, the moment when a person for a moment acknowledged another's humanity? And how different that was to meeting a face you didn't know on the Ark, realizing you might see them again, probably would see them again, now that you'd noticed them. Only 16,000 on board. Everybody you met you didn't know knew someone you knew, eventually. How peculiar it must have been to live a life of disconnection, an Earth life. Shimalus tried to remember, but so much had faded, replaced by shadowy containers reaching to dark ceilings by the Ark's breathing and clicking distant echoes of doors closing and machinery and voices. He closed his eyes. Clouds on the horizon with the sun behind them were a cliché, a garish extremity of color and contrast, but the clouds in the west emerging from night asked for attention quietly. Subtleties of line and shade, immensities of implication. Maybe his cloud would sit atop gauzy Virga, lightest brushstrokes that hardly touched the wall. Hua smiled as he approached. That's your bird too, isn't it? She pointed to the starling. Is it that obvious? Good guess. You have a style. I couldn't see anything else of yours, though. No. A dab here, a dab there. Shimalus unpacked an art kit. Somebody replenished the paints regularly, and the brushes were immaculate. He liked the potential in unsqueezed pigments and the invitation of a clean palette board. Hua turned back to her piece of the wall. She drew her brush across the metal in short, confident curves, leaving behind graceful blades of grass. I thought I'd do a hillock here, maybe the top of a Viking burial mound. There could be a perfectly preserved longboat under this. It will take a while, I think, to get it right.
Who will know about the boat? Asked Shimalus.
Just me. Secrets are fun, but I think I paint differently knowing the hill covers an explorer's boat. I like to think it shows subconsciously. I hear a sail snapping in the wind as I paint the groaning oars. A short man with slender wrists, white eyebrows, and the wisp of white hair above his ears picked up an art kit and headed south. Hua turned to watch the man leave. That's Cleo. He's adding a lighthouse to the beach. Also, he's dynamite with ocean swell. Nobody paints water in motion better than he does. There's a wave where the light shines through the breaker at the top. It's translucent and glows. Lovely technique. Truly lovely. Totally self-taught. Never took instruction. Interesting person if you can get him to talk. Quiet guy.
Admirable of him, said Shimalus.
He drew a line to capture the cloud's lower shape and immediately wiped it away. He needed to do the underlayment first, but he wanted a sense of its dimensions before he started. He might not get to the cloud itself for weeks.
Ah, said Hua. I get the hint.
They worked side by side silently for an hour until Shimalus packed his supplies. Duty calls, he said, as if he had a job to get to. He wondered what Hua did on the Ark, but if he asked, she might ask back, and the less she knew, the less she was curious about, the better.
Coffee? She said.
Shimalus shook his head. I'm running late. He walked north. That was twice she'd invited him. In the years he'd been on board, skulking, really, if he had to describe it, knowing no one beyond a wave or a hello, he managed to stay invisible. All facilities were open to him. No one asked for identification when he did laundry or replaced his work clothes or attended lectures. He ate alone. He paused on the high sky bridge over the hydroponic gardens and contemplated rows and rows of herbs and vegetables and grains, careful not to talk to anyone. and he could have continued for years more if the mural hadn't caught his eye, if he hadn't begun to fear he was forgetting at all where he'd come from, who he was. So he painted the starling, also a wren that Hua missed, then the bluebird, and told Hua his name. More people were in the hall than he normally saw going both directions, some turning at the junction ahead, some continuing on. He glanced back. He thought a man he'd seen earlier, blue shirt, shoulder bag, stopped when he saw them. The man turned around and went the other way. Shimalus waited by a service hatch until no one could see him enter. For 13 years, the wire-filled, tube-filled, pipe-filled corridors had been his home. He knew them better than he knew the streets where he grew up. He knew the ladders and stairs, ramps and crannies. He went to the nearest supply closet, equipped himself with a sniffer, ultraviolet light, and disinfectants to do what he'd been doing daily, finding mold and bacteria just as he had at the Marriott. A human shed, 9 pounds of skin, sells a year, flaking off them like a dust storm. The population of the Ark added 144,000 pounds of dead skin annually, adrift in the air, covering surfaces, but also riding the ventilation system, setting on the inner bowels, supplying microbiomes necessary nutrients. Molds that weaken plastics and pitted metal, bacteria that mutated, mostly from one benign being to another, but potentially pathogenic. Human skin cells, over time, became an enclosed habitat's greatest threat, along with lint, hair, and other constantly generated waste, the basis for an entire microbiology. An environment where crickets could survive. Without people, the Ark wouldn't need nearly the attention. During the early years, when he hid most, he cleaned constantly. He might be uninvited, but he didn't have to be useless. Sometimes he met other techs in the tunnels, like Linda the fungus girl, rags in hand, bleach sprays hanging from their belts, and they nodded in passing. Shimalus felt a camaraderie in their lonely, unsung quests. Linda spoke to him once. "Did you see the memo on Aspergillus flavus? Really hate mycotoxins." The thing about generation ships is the untested technology. A simulation predicts a mechanism's life over 100 years, a guess at best, and an Ark ship functioned through thousands of mechanisms and systems of mechanisms, interacting in unpredictable ways. That's how desperate Earth became, investing in a desperate chance. A planet's population acts like a single organism when pressed and does anything to survive, gnaws off a leg even, or devote entire economies to building life rafts to other stars, allowing a tiny, tiny percentage of people a hope to survive. Not that they'd finish the trip, but their descendants, dozens of generations removed, might. If the arcs work long enough, if the people on board avoid disease and dysfunction, if a planet at Zeta Reticuli is livable. He wondered if they predicted Latimer or someone like him. The Ark included machine shops and fabrication equipment to repair and remake the vessel over centuries. When they arrived at Zeta Reticuli, there might not be a single piece of original equipment left. Could they even claim it was the same ship? So they must have also written guidelines for handling the 16,000. The rule that Latimer and his 11 acolytes would be dumped out an airlock for crimes against the mission existed before he instigated this futile rebellion. Procedures to protect the greater good must have already existed, and if they had a rule that encompassed Latimer, they would have also had one for a stowaway. Surely he would be considered to have committed a crime against the mission. Rules, standards, testing, computer simulations, best guesses piled on earnest engineering. Every crapshoot Ark ship traveling to their separate destinations crossed faith with luck. Dice danced on the felt. The silver ball spun above numbered slots. Cards fell to the table. Terrible odds. Certainty balanced against a chance. Shimalus retreated to his sleep chamber. Had he been followed in the hall? Had the woman in the cafeteria been watching? He sat in the dark, bouncing between paranoid thoughts, and he knew they were paranoid. Why would he have been discovered now? If they suspected he didn't belong, why would they watch him instead of just grabbing him? He had an immediate fear, too, as he worked from one bad possibility to another. The storage area where he lived was comfortably dark. It gave the illusion of safety, a blanket he drew over himself, but powerful lights could easily be turned on. The darkness provided no cover other than someone looking in would see the lights were off and assume the room was unoccupied. When he was a young man on Earth, when the mutagen wasn't dominating the news yet, he and a friend went late at night to an old gym at a small college in a town to play basketball. The back door was never locked. They stepped into the darkened room, turned on the lights, and cockroaches scurried for cover, skittering across the worn wood floor, some of them dashing back and forth as if they couldn't decide on a direction, until they found a wall with molding they slipped under. When they turned the lights on in the storage area, he'd be the same cockroach. He shone the light around the space. If he could walk to the spot, so could anyone. He'd felt secure until now, but the look the woman in the cafeteria gave him didn't feel accidental. The man in the hall who turned away might have nothing to do with him, but maybe he did. Who asking him to dinner or coffee could be innocent, but what if she suspected? The storage container beside him was as large as a rail car, and two more were stacked atop it. But on the side of the container were recessed steps, a ladder for workmen. Shimmerless, with the pen light in his mouth, and climbed. 30 feet higher, he reached the top of the third container. A 2.5-foot space separated the top from the ceiling. He climbed down, tied the blanket into a sling to hang from his shoulder, and then put his clothes and mattress inside. The return to the container's top was an awkward climb, but now he'd be harder to discover. Shimmerless didn't sleep. He stared at the ceiling so close to his face, listening. If the hatch opened, he'd hear it. But he heard everything else, too. Ventilation turning on and off, creaks, snaps, rumbles, then a thrumming rhythm he'd never noticed. He strained to identify it. Was it the pneumatic transit carrying supplies and people across the ring? Was it a pounding from a manufacturing process or liquids moving through pipes? It beat so distinctly, he feared an arc-wide failure. Soon his ears would pop in response to air escaping, or he'd go to the hatch and the lights would be out, a service corridor too. The powerless habitat would lose temperature, freezing them all, or perhaps the gargantuan metal ring would break apart, pieces and people flying every direction, maybe to never stop. Was the thrumming a harbinger? What was that? Why had he never noticed it before? For minutes he listened, and then he laughed a raucous break in the silence. The awful sound was his own pulse. He laughed until he was weak from it. His ribs ached. I'm going insane, he thought, and maybe that made him giggle too, because surely if he was going insane, he wouldn't recognize it. Still, he didn't emerge into public areas for 2 weeks, living off food in the maintenance locker room refrigerator. He didn't stop until he found a note on a bagged sandwich that said, "This is Ben's meal. Don't steal it again." He held Ben's sandwich for a minute, which looked sad and unappetizing in its bag, realized he would be eating it if it weren't for the note. Decided he was tired of hiding. So Shimmerless put on a fresh set of work clothes, made the long journey through the halls, hatches, ladders, and stairs to a service corridor exit, then to the nearest cafeteria. He was pleased to see brownies back on the desserts. He took two of them to go with the roasted cauliflower and gravy main dish and an English muffin. A meal hadn't tasted so good to him for a long time. As far as he could tell, no one paid special attention. Hua wasn't at the painting, though. She'd made considerable progress on her Viking mound. 6 feet long, it rose to waist height in the mural's foreground. Purple and yellow heather climbed up one side and fringed the top. No background yet, but a continuation of the forest on the other side of the meadow seemed likely. Deeper into the mural, his bluebird looked more vivid than he remembered. He wondered if it had been edited by a better artist. The underlayment he'd applied above, waiting for his cloud, remained untouched, not that he'd have a chance to finish it. Cleo knelt on a pad, adding tiny leaves to a bush that hadn't been there the last time Shimmerless worked on the painting. "Have you seen Hua?" Shimmerless said. Cleo straightened, sitting on his heels. Shimmerless thought he was years older than him, but even though Cleo didn't have much hair and what he had was white, lines didn't mark his face, which made sense. None of the original crew was older than 40. Hua? Shimmerless pointed at the Viking mound. "That's her work. Mostly she does branches." You're a little early. If she comes today. See her most days, new to the painting, aren't you? You're Mr. Bluebird." Shimmerless nodded. I haven't tried an animal. I'm more of a flowers and twig guy now. That's my tree trunk next to the Ribbon Falls. Spent over a year doing it. Enjoy the smaller projects after that when I do a pretty mean leaf, too. Shimmelis opened an art kit. Fresh paints, clean brush. I'd like to tackle a big subject someday, he said wistfully, without conviction. After today, he wouldn't be allowed to paint again if they let him live. They were just making conversation, after all. Doubt filled him. Intention leaked away. Why not stay hidden? He was good at it, and he wanted to do the cloud and other clouds, and he had a vision of a bird-filled glade. Sunlight shafts, dusty with pollen, would fall between the trees. He could smell the forest, the wet, verdant breeze swept colors and contrast that closing his eyes wouldn't send away. Bird calls filled the air. He imagined a woodpecker tapping. Chirps, trills, long trailing whistles, a cascading western meadowlark melody repeated in the distance. That could be his years-long project. If he ran away now, if he stayed quiet, he could do it. Hi, Shimmelis, said Hua. Shimmelis closed his art kit, put it on the table. He looked sadly at the space where he pictured his cloud, knowing he'd never be able to paint. I'll take you up on that coffee if you're still willing. I have something to get off my chest. Sweat beaded on his forehead as they walked toward Chef Charisse's cafe. He could still disappear, but when Hua turned into the entrance, he followed. They took a table in a corner. Hua faced him, her hands wrapped around her coffee cup as if she were cold. Shimmelis pictured Latimer and his 11 followers waiting their sentencing. They'd occupied one of the hydroponic gardens, barricaded the entrances, and threatened to poison the plants if their demands weren't met. The details seem silly now, something about forming an independent fiefdom with Latimer as the feudal lord to preserve cultural integrity. The cafeteria was empty. Oh, this is pleasant, said Hua. Now that they were seated, Shimmelis didn't know how to start. He hadn't had a real conversation for 12 years. Cleo came through the door. Hua waved him over. Shimmelis didn't think Cleo and Hua knew each other very well. He took a seat next to her, facing Shimmelis. It didn't matter if Cleo heard, though. Shimmelis thought he might as well shout it to the cafeteria. I'm an interloper. I'm not one of you. Someone from security would come and take him to a magistrate, and then it would be a short trip to an airlock. Maybe they wouldn't even bother with a trial. Cleo held a coffee in one hand and pastry in the other. What do you call a gathering of painters? Hua said. A colony? Appropriate, don't you think, considering? Cleo laughed. I also heard the term a misbelief of painters. It came from early portrait artists who were asked to make their subjects more beautiful than they were. I like that one better. Despite himself, despite feeling his confession was written on his face, Shimmelis said, you don't think the mural is an accurate portrait? Nobody's put in a polluted sky or a dying tree, but I don't think it would matter if we did. Painting is always interpretive. What we paint reveals more of the painter than the subject. Well, aren't we all talkative today? Said Hua. Shimmelis turned his attention from one to the other. This is what it's like to belong, he thought. This is being a member of the clan, and he gripped his fists under the table. After all this time, what he thought was important, escaping Earth, being safe, didn't matter. For 12 years, hiding, he didn't feel safe. He didn't feel honest or real. His best moments in sneaking aboard the Ark were the last few months when he stood in the open, painting a bird on the generation ship wall. He checked the cafeteria again, empty except for the three of them, a small consolation. What if they screamed or backed away as if he were an infection? I'm illegal. Hua stopped whatever she was about to say. Shimmelis continued, afraid he'd freeze up. I'm not a colonist. I'm not approved. I snuck aboard and have been sleeping in the storage area since launch. Cleo and Hua's expressions were unreadable. I'm a stowaway. Behind them, in the hall beyond the cafeteria entrance, people passed back and forth, intent on whatever whims or responsibilities occupied their time. For a moment, motion slowed. He thought that if he dropped his cup off the table, it would take minutes to hit the floor. Their silence lingered. Ship sounds faded, footsteps, conversation, machinery, ventilation whispered away until he heard again his own heartbeat that had scared him so. Cleo tapped the table with his fingertips. "Should I do it?" he asked Hua. She nodded. Cleo pushed away, walked out of earshot to the entrance, then chatted into his vox, glancing at them. Hua didn't appear horrified or incredulous. Shimalis started to speak. Hua raised her hand. "Oh, wait." "So this is how it will end," thought Shimalis, as Cleo rejoined them. Soon security would arrive to take him. A woman in maintenance overalls walked into the cafeteria, sat at a near table. It was Linda, the fungus girl. Then Jerome, the nutritionist from the Get Me There eatery, joined her, followed by the woman in the white smock he thought had been watching him earlier. They didn't go to the buffet. Within a minute, half dozen other came to the cafeteria. Another artist from the Long Mural, two more maintenance workers he'd seen occasionally in the tunnels, and the door greeter from the Grand Grill. They sat near each other, looking at him inscrutably, chatting quietly among themselves. "What's going on?" he asked. "You or me," said Hua to Cleo. Cleo responded. "You founded the club. Go ahead." Hua squared her shoulders, reached across the table, and touched Shimalis's hand. "We know about you." Shimalis looked from one to the other. Everyone else in the cafeteria, all that he'd seen before, fell silent. "What do you mean?" "Jerome spotted you first in the Get Me There almost 12 years ago before we passed beyond Venus. You didn't know how to dispense coffee. You left your tray on the table. When he asked you if you had enough carbohydrates, you said, sure, when everyone else said, yes, and thank you. You caught on to our habits pretty quick after that, but it was enough."
8 weeks into the trip, and we already needed hobbies. You became ours. We didn't tell administration for a long time. There were arguments about that, but we searched your belongings. We checked your background on Earth and the Marriott. By the time we'd left the solar system, it was clear you meant no harm."
"And you were doing more micro-abatement than anyone on the crew. You're the last of the stowaways to reveal themselves."
Shimalis looked back and forth between the two artists.
"There were others?"
"It's a big ship," Hua said. She smiled, stood up, extended a hand across the table.
"I've waited a long time to say this. We thought you might never stop hiding."
Her hand felt warm and gripped firm.
"Welcome aboard, Shimalis."
Everyone applauded, and in a moment they surrounded him, clapping him on the back, giving him hugs. In his 12 years hiding aboard the Ark, Shimalis had never been in a personal cabin. Plenty of wall space for shelves or art, a comfortable bed, a mini kitchen, his own shower, a table with chairs for guests. But he slept restlessly there. The huge warehouse rooms never echoed back his breathing. The distance from the entrance to where he used to sleep was hundreds of feet, not just a few strides away. He couldn't hear footsteps from beyond his door, but he imagined people walking past. On the third night in his new room, closeness and strangeness finally drove him from bed. He slipped through his door, and into the living quarters corridor. He carried a blanket and pillow, hoping no one would ask where he was going. He entered the first maintenance hatch he came to, walked in the familiar half-light, caught whiffs of detergents and antibacterial treatments, retreated into the familiar rhythm of his footsteps on the metal floor, until he came to a storage area entrance. Here the ceiling rose high above him, and the containers, most filled with equipment that wouldn't be unpacked for 1,000 years, loomed on both sides, creating a canyon that few on the Ark visited. He wove down the passages till he came to a ladder, climbed to the top where only 2.5 feet separated him from the container and the ceiling, spread his blanket, and rested his head on the pillow. He didn't close his eyes. Too much to think about. The storage room was no longer home. Given time, he'd grow used to being a part of the crew. He'd find routines that would shape his day, new ones that didn't mean hiding his identity, that didn't create fear and paranoia. He would paint more. He would fit in. But for now, the container top felt good. Somewhere, in the storage area, a cricket began chirping, a tiny, brave voice announcing its unasked-for presence in a space that was never made for it.
Shimalis sighed, relaxed into the dark, and slept. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment over at the Clarkesworld Magazine About Us page. Our contact information is listed there. So if you'd like to say something, please pick an email address and send an email. We have more stories left for you for the month of November. I do hope you can come back and join us should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.